What's up, everyone? In this video, we're going to talk about some module diagnostics. I'm in our 2018 Chevy Volt. This Volt is something that we purchased from a local dealer. We were able to get a great price on it because it was in a hailstorm. So you can see the whole exterior of this thing looks like a golf ball. All the panels, trim work, back glass was broken, got replaced. Pretty heavily damaged car, but for us, cosmetic, right? We're gonna work on it, we're gonna drive it, use it for education. So we get this car, and really the only thing, the glass got replaced, got repaired. The only thing that was still not functional was the radio. And so you can see it power up the car, dash lights up, go to the radio, I got nothing. No screen, no response, right? And so we're gonna go through the process of how do I decide what the issue is, right? If I'm working on this, and what that process could look like. All right, so our first step, we're gonna hook up a scan tool. So we've got the MDI-2 plugged in, we've got GDS going here, go to Diagnostics, get our vehicle read, and we're gonna go to Vehicle Diagnostics here, Vehicle DTC Information. This screen is gonna scan the whole vehicle, scan all the control modules that the vehicle has. One of the good things about this is that I can see real quick whether I've got correlations, right? If I've got one system that I understand is down, that's my concern, right? Radio is inoperative. But if I see other trends, other modules that are down or faults that exist, that's gonna help me narrow into where the issue is. One of the other cool things on here is that the far right column where it says DLC pin, it tells me essentially which network, if I go run and look at, you know, 6 and 14, if I look at some of these numbers, I can know, hey, that's on the CAN high speed, or that's on one of the lower, you know, LAN low speed, or one of the other networks. So here we've got them all scanned. I'm gonna sort by status, and there's my radio. No communication. It communicates on pin 1, and then I got a handful of others that also do not communicate. So these first two, multi-axis acceleration, active safety control module, one of those is on my CAN. Then a whole list of other things, right? One of the challenges when you do a full vehicle scan, it may or may not be apparent which module should be there, right? Not all vehicles are equipped with every module that was offered. And so like in this case of this car, we have the base radio package. We don't have the amplifier with the subwoofer. It's apparent in the rear of the car where the subwoofer would be. How would you find that out? You would have to perhaps look at the RPO code on something like a General Motors product and verify that, but that is going to take an extra step. The other stuff that I had to do some research to determine was the active safety control module. That is something that's not offered or not equipped on this particular car, right? And so those are good things to know. So we're left with this whole list with radio, we're leaving off the amp, but radio, some object detection control modules, park assist, steering column lock. Further research is going to show us that most of these modules are not equipped on this car and that we don't need to worry about them. But if I was concerned about that, if I thought that, hey, pin one has a lot of modules that look like they're down, is pin one doing okay, right? Can it communicate? Is that network okay? So one thing we can do to verify that out, I've got my PicoScope box hooked up here, and I've got that single channel lead plugged into my breakout box, right? So this is hooked up to pin one. One of the cool things with this breakout box is that you do get a flashing light. And so I can see that, hey, pin one has got some kind of voltage going through it. So here I've got my trace. It's running about 5 volts, and it's got packets of information flowing, right? And so that settles a little bit of my concern for, hey, a lot of stuff on pin one looked funny. This shows me there's active engagement, there's communication occurring on that line, right? And so let's move forward and really hone in on just that radio module. So the next thing I'm gonna do is go to service info and learn more about how is the radio module and configuration on this car set up? Where's that module located? All those things. So I'm here in service info, I'm gonna go down and look for radio. I've got a couple of different things. I've got some bulletins, right? I could stop and take a look at these bulletins. So they've got intermittent radio blank issues. I didn't see any relevant TSBs, so let's look at the service procedure, see if that helps me understand where it's located. control assembly, if we start there, that looks to be the screen, right? That's my element up front. That part is not turning on, so a little bit of concern there. Down here, they talk about radio replacement. When I look at this, I get a picture, and hey, look, this is in the rear of the vehicle. And remember we talked about this was a hail car, and that back glass was broken. So let's go to the back of the car and just look for maybe any signs of water intrusion or problems there. All right, so we got the back of the car, a little bit apart here. Right over here in the corner, that is my radio module. And you can see, we've already done a little bit of vacuuming, but lots of glass left over in this. And if you look at the inverter and some of the hybrid unit stuff here, you can see a lot of different corrosion just on the aluminum, right? So we've got some definite signs of water intrusion. This module is not very high up, right? It's only maybe an inch, 2 inches off that floor panel section there. So let's do some more checks and see if we've got everything we need supplied to this. All right, so back to service information. We're going to go look at some diagrams just for our radio. I'm going to pick without amplifier. All right, so what I'm going to do next is what we would do next is use this diagram to look at what are my power inputs and my ground, verify that those exist, those are still okay. You know, I've got power coming in, I've got a good ground. So we'll go do that with the DVOM, we'll come back with some results. All right, so we did some tests using that information. So I went back to the module, checked for 12 volts in, checked for ground, also looked for the network bus and saw activity there on the scope, just like we saw at the DLC. So all of these things point toward that module itself is bad, right? The module itself is not powering up, it's not communicating, it's not operating within the system. So we're gonna get a new module coming. We'll put that in and go through the programming procedure for it. We've got the new module plugged in, it's mounted in the back, and we came back here, ran DTCs on this module, and you can see there's a couple kind of weird antenna issue modules, but the big one that stands out is that over here for the infotainment faceplate control module, it says variant not programmed. And this code makes a lot of sense because when you go to try to work the radio, it does power up now, it does function, but the buttons at the bottom of the faceplate do not represent what you would expect them to. You push the home button, all the buttons, they're really mixed up. So that's a clear sign that we're gonna have to do some programming to get this module set up to work with this vehicle properly. All right, so here we're in the service programming system tool for General Motors. So I'm gonna go in and select replace and program an ECU. To get to this screen, I had to pay $40 for this particular VIN to be coded. So we gotta tell it what we're working on. We've got our Chevrolet 18, it's a Volt. In this next screen, I'm gonna get a list of all the modules in the car. And so I'm gonna pick the one that I want to program. We're gonna verify the VIN. Here's my list of modules. I'm gonna select my radio. For programming, normal style programming, hit next. So then here on this screen, you get this breakdown of different calibrations that exist within the module. And so you can kind of flip through these and you can see what calibration number or version we're on. And then at history, they tell you some things about maybe updates or changes that were made for these various parts of this module, right? It's got several pieces of software in it. Navigated through this for a minute and then went back to the operating system, hit next. It tells me some of the outline of calibrations. I hit next and we get to this screen where the software is going to communicate with a server at General Motors to get the proper calibration file and download it. Once it's downloaded, then it will use the VCI, the MDI2 interface, to basically upload that software and install it in the module in the car. And anytime we do this, it's important that we get a power supply hooked up to the car, so not just a battery charger, but a power supply that generally puts the voltage somewhere north of 13 volts, and it's a really clean DC inverter style power supply. So we want to keep everything active. Low voltage events can create problems and sometimes create a paperweight out of a module. So here we're all done. It tells me action is complete. I get some documentation about things that would be relevant for this module. I get a choice down at the bottom. I could clear DTCs to complete my job. And let's go check out the car and see if it works. So a lot of new vehicles, you replace a module, it has to be paired, it has to be coded, right? It has to have the VIN entered into it, and the calibration, you know, the software files that are in there have to match the particular vehicle. You know, a lot of these modules are made and implemented across multiple chassis and platforms, and so you've got to code it to get things to work. So this scenario for our car, buttons not being in the correct spot, everything still worked, but made it very difficult to use because things were backwards, right? And so that was a good outlook about how to program some things, some of that diagnostic flow for something like a bad module. Water intrusion is always a really interesting process to go through. It's creates a lot of different outcomes and a lot of really interesting ones. So if you ever have water intrusion on a car, that can really create for an interesting scenario. Thanks for watching. Hope you got something good out of it.